The Austro-Hungarian Empire has earned a reputation among historians as a textbook case of imperial futility and of disunity among so diverse and expansive a state. It seemingly joins the ranks of such failed multinational powers as Yugoslavia, the Ottoman Empire, Gran Colombia, the USSR, and arguably, the Roman Empire. States which, like Austro-Hungary, attempted to house and govern vast swaths of land occupied by people so different and divergent that to break up along ethnic and cultural lines became their only solution. This path appeared evident even since before the Austro-Hungarian Empire was the Austro-Hungarian Empire, in the days when it was merely recognized by its leading national power, Austria. Beginning as little more than a duchy within the Holy Roman Empire, left in the care of the Habsburg line, Austria for centuries would neighbor the larger kingdoms of Bohemia and of Hungary, the latter of which included the lands of Croatia, Slavonia, and Transylvania. Both kingdoms eventually came under the rule of a shared monarch of the Polish-Lithuanian Jagiellonian dynasty, who had arisen to become a regular rival to the Habsburgs. Jagiellonian rule in both realms would come to an end upon the invasion of Hungary by the Ottoman Empire in 1520, when King Louis II fell in battle with no legitimate heirs. Hungary and Bohemia were elective monarchies at the time, but more immediate relatives were often preferred. As such, future Holy Roman Emperor and brother-in-law to Louis, Ferdinand I of Habsburg, was eyed as an ideal successor, although Ferdinand's claim was still met with opposition in both realms. As both Holy Roman Emperor and King of Hungary, Bohemia, and Croatia, Ferdinand set a standard of ruling his realms individually and with due respect to the distinct cultures and traditions of each realm. Hungary seemingly retaining the greatest level of autonomy thanks to its larger population and a centuries-old uncodified constitution, which limited royal authority in favor of the local parliament. Hungarian autonomy within the Habsburg monarchy went as far as the Hungarians preserving their own customs borders, the majority of their legislative government, and much more. Despite this, issues still arose between the Habsburgs and their diverse domains over the next two centuries, Hungary especially proving to be quite troublesome. Decade after decade, Austria came to form a more significant center of Habsburg power, which now sought to assume a more directly leading role in its union with Bohemia, Hungary, and Croatia. However, persisting differences between the realms led to diverging goals and ambitions, not to mention rising hostilities between overlapping ethnic and religious groups as the realms exchanged populations over time. These issues, along with the rise of Napoleon in France threatening the hegemony of the Habsburgs in the HRE, eventually motivated Holy Roman Emperor Francis II to consolidate his family's realms into a proper empire with Austria at its heart, thus officially creating the Austrian Empire. In large part, little had actually changed domestically following Austria's elevation to the status of an empire, though Austria seemingly found itself in increased disagreement with Hungary where national sentiment was rising even in spite of its relative freedom within the empire. Some have even argued that this freedom only heightened Hungarian nationalism and sense of sovereignty, since it never truly developed a codependency with Austria and thus never invested itself or sought to integrate on even the minor scale the other realms had. Now, the early era of this newly established Austrian Empire would see politics dominated by Chancellor Clemens von Metternich, who, in an attempt to stave off the waves of liberalism and nationalism which had been turned loose by Napoleon and now threatened Austrian unity, suppressed and censored such movements across the empire, only for regional nationalism to build up beneath the surface, and ultimately erupt during the revolutions of 1848, when the Hungarians initially pressed for parliamentary rule and an end to censorship, seeing their demands met by the Austrian government only to have demands served upon them by the ethnic minorities within their realm, demands which weren't so easy for the Hungarian government to deliver. During this time, the Austrian Emperor Ferdinand I, seen as both mentally unfit to rule and only capable of agreeing to all of Hungary's demands, was replaced by his nephew Franz Joseph, who revoked Ferdinand's agreements with Hungary and initiated a military campaign to bring the Hungarians back into order. The Hungarians, in response, now demanded total independence and forced the Austrians to call upon Russian support to finally subdue the rebellious state. In the wake of the conflict, Austria, under the guidance of its new emperor, had considered that perhaps it had been too lenient with Hungary over the years, and so placed the realm under fierce military rule and revoked several of the freedoms previously allowed. The Austrian Empire took a realistic look at itself and saw an entity that was too generous to function as a united empire, and too uncooperative to become a united federation. It was decided that the Austrian Empire could no longer be a loose union of distinct kingdoms who merely shared a monarch, but must instead pursue a policy of creating a unitary identity through a Germanization or Austroization process. This policy penetrated from the governmental to the individual level, and for a time seemed to achieve the desired effect, that is, until 1866, when Austria was utterly defeated by Prussia in the Austro-Prussian War, costing the Austrians their sphere of influence within both Germany and Italy, as well as crippling the empire morally, militarily, and financially. Austria could no longer afford to subjugate its minority kingdoms, and so, in 1867, begrudgingly established with the Hungarians a dual monarchy, the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Not only was the Kingdom of Hungary once again autonomous, but now remained linked to Austria merely through foreign and defensive policies, as well as through a shared monarch, but again one who didn't hold much pull within Hungary itself. For most intents and purposes, Hungary was essentially independent. Many who once supported total Hungarian independence now came to favor this outcome instead, as they came to recognize Hungarian and Austrian foreign policy as sharing a similar outlook, something which would prove misguided when the Austrians attempted to support France in the Franco-Prussian War, only to be held back by the Hungarians. Hungary also stood to benefit greatly from Austria's advancement, wealth, and strength. This granting of what amounted to equal status within the empire to Hungary raised the attention of the empire's other ethnic groups, most notably the South and Western Slavs, whose combined populations made up 14 and 34% of the empire's total population respectively. Yet despite this, still remained subject to the larger Austrian and Hungarian governments. As was the case during Hungary's revolution, the Hungarians were hesitant to share power with their minority populations, and in fact pursued a Hungarianization or Magyarization program within their lands, whilst the Austrians in contrast issued a nationalities law within their half of the empire, which enshrined equal rights, the right to preserve one's own culture and language, and so on. The dualism of the monarchy almost immediately proved unsatisfactory, and led to the prominence of what was known as trialism, the creation of a third equal kingdom within the Austro-Hungarian Empire to represent the Slavic population. Both Bohemia and Croatia were considered as contenders for this position, but Croatia emerged as a purer option as Bohemia held a significant German presence within its borders. This choice ultimately drove a divide between Austria and the Western Slavs of Bohemia, Slovakia, and Galicia, whose identity differed significantly from the South Slavic cultures of Croatia, Slavonia, Dalmatia, Slovenia, and Bosnia. Trialism as a concept was quickly gaining support among the Austrian elite, Franz Joseph having at least considered it an option, his successor Emperor Karl I having repeatedly moved for the establishment of Croatia as a third kingdom, only to be blocked by Hungary until it was too late, and Franz Ferdinand having taken interest in a reorganization of Austro-Hungary into various semi-autonomous states within a federation known as the United States of Greater Austria. With several checks and mutual dependencies established to ensure each state is capable of preserving its culture independently, but is encouraged to remain a part of the greater whole. Some have even speculated that this idea held such potential that it was in fact the true justification for the Archduke's assassination by the Serbian Black Hand, also known as unification or death, because the outcome would have sufficiently appeased Yugoslav populations within the empire and even raised their standard of living so far that it would have crushed Serbian plans to establish Yugoslavia as a united pan-South Slavic state. Of course, Ferdinand was assassinated, the Great War broke out, and the stress of both the conflict and unresolved internal disputes ultimately led Austro-Hungary to collapse. But what if that changed? What if in an alternate timeline, the United States of Greater Austria were established? The first key question we face is when, and of course how. Theoretically, we could propose the creation of a third kingdom within the empire as early as 1868, when Croatia and Hungary made a compromise which essentially made it an autonomous realm of Hungary, though not fully incorporated as an equal to its larger neighbors. Later down the line, this could rekindle interest in a West Slavic kingdom between the Czechs, Slovaks, Poles, and Ukrainians, but this isn't truly the United States of Austria model. That specific partition wouldn't be proposed until 1906, and even then was only of interest to Archduke Franz Ferdinand, who, as the assumed heir to the Austrian throne, certainly could have put the plan into action if only he had been given the chance. Again, Ferdinand was assassinated, and this wasn't merely an assassination we could wave off with minimal consequences. Ferdinand's death had been the spark which triggered the Great War, and merely suggesting that he survive already has great implications for the timeline which we'll want to avoid for this scenario. Finally, we might propose a timeline in which Emperor Karl Franz Joseph's successor by the end of the war is able to negotiate an early peace through the US, and with the support of Woodrow Wilson, fashion Austria as a model for what an ideal post-war state could be. Strong, united, but still able to preserve the right to self-determination for all its people within an imperial-sized state. The appeal could be quite strong, as Wilson would no doubt recognize the unwillingness of the European empires to simply surrender their colonial lands for the sake of a future for self-deterministic nation-states, however, might be more likely to adopt a cooperative federal model if Austria could prove it to be successful. The British had, after all, considered such a thing just some years earlier, so perhaps an example is all that was needed to drive Europe's empires down this path. Let's first consider an early proto-US of Austria model, We might assume that in the year following the Austro-Hungarian Compromise, Croatia is able to successfully negotiate with not merely the Hungarians but Austria as well, to establish itself as a third kingdom. Such an outcome would very likely motivate a similar response from Bohemia not long after. The Slavic lands of Polish Galicia, Ukrainian Galicia, and Slovakia, though possibly capable of creating a 5th, 6th, and 7th kingdom, are more likely to simply throw their lot in with Bohemia, who would have already had a strong historic basis for equal status, already held greater established connections with Austria proper, and in the case of Slovakia, offered a reliable escape from Hungarian domination, which, if a united West Slavic kingdom failed to manifest, could still see Galicia and Bohemia emerge as autonomous powers within the empire, but Slovakia itself would very likely remain under Hungarian control. This further breakup of power would give imperial decisions a more democratic character, as Hungary would no longer be able to simply veto Austrian proposals if the Austrians were able to net the support of the other two kingdoms, allowing for more ambitious expansion efforts into South Slavic lands, which Hungary opposed out of concern that it would embolden Croatia. If we assume this reorganization of the empire occurs early enough, Austria may also participate in the Franco-Prussian War, though the outcome is likely to remain mostly the same. If the losses were severe enough, it might even lead the kingdoms of Austria to break up into fully independent states soon after, but we'll assume that's not the case. With Yugoslav culture given its own independent sphere within the empire, Austria would likely be able to better negotiate a total annexation of Bosnia following the Russo-Turkish War, without compromising the League of the Three Emperors so early on, being met more favorably by both the local population and by Russia, who wouldn't need to be concerned with the suppression of Bosnia's Slavic population once under Austrian influence. That said, the two would still be in rivalry for dominance in the Balkans, and see debate over further southward expansion by Austria. An earlier annexation of Bosnia leaves additional opportunity to cut off Serbia from Montenegro by consolidating control over Sanjak, paving the way for a long-term domination of the Western Balkans, much to the displeasure of Russia, whose earlier tolerance of Austria on account of its pro-Slavic reforms would have allowed this to occur. This expansion would no doubt set the stage for decades of conflict between the two, the Austrians supporting the Turks against the pan-Slavic expansion of Russian-backed Bulgaria and Serbia, whilst itself slowly creeping down toward Macedonia and Albania, on occasion receiving support from Britain and Germany, the British aiming to deny Russia access to the Mediterranean, whilst the Germans hoped to foster a reliable relationship with both Austria and the Ottomans against Russia, once the League of the Three Emperors began to decay. Overall, the greater enthusiasm that could be drawn from the Austro-Slavic kingdoms would allow Austria to play a more dynamic role in developing conflicts, especially those in the Balkans where Slavic interests were concerned, and where Austria proper saw its final opportunity to reignite the flames powering the imperial engine. Alternatively, we could assume Franz Ferdinand survived to take power in a world where the Great War never happened. He would succeed Franz Joseph around the same time Karl I had, and without the need to focus resources on an external conflict, attention could be directed to the Yugoslav question, which would become a chief issue following the annexation of Bosnia. In our world, these discussions still took place even despite the war, as the united Yugoslav movement and animosity with Russia firmly bonded the future of the Austro-Slavs to the survival of the empire itself. Hungary, as in our world, would continue to resist the matter, but in a timeline where Ferdinand survived to become emperor, he, being a no-nonsense man who expressly viewed the dual monarchy as a faulty system, would pressure the Hungarians by any means possible to not only elevate Croatia-Slavonia to the level of an equal within the empire, but to accept terms of federation already supported by the various groups which surrounded ethnic Hungarian lands. It's quite possible this ultimatum could trigger a war between Hungary and Austria, the latter having the support of nearly the entire empire behind it, whilst the former saw minor support from Serbia and Russia, who stood to benefit from Austria's collapse. As was the case following the Hungarian Revolution, Austria would place Hungary under a temporary military occupation and assume total control of local institutions in order to censor anti-Austrian media and promote a more cooperative pro-federation message in schools, news, politics, and entertainment. Ferdinand saw Hungary as a long-standing thorn in the side of unity for the states of Austria, and would likely not have been satisfied until every remnant of anti-Habsburg Hungarian radicalism was eradicated. As we mentioned before, in our world while the Great War raged on, Austria continued to negotiate with Hungary for the creation of a third crown, knowing well that a defeat would almost certainly see a breakaway of Slavic lands, only for the proposal to be repeatedly shot down anyway. However, given the demands of the conflict, Austria simply couldn't afford to pressure Hungary at the time, an outcome in which the United States of Austria's proposed during the war would very likely see similar resistance from Hungary, and ultimately fail to produce lasting results. Even in the unlikely outcome the proposition has passed, Austria would still perform roughly as it did in our timeline and still break up, though now along prior established lines. It is true that domestic resistance from various ethnic groups hindered Austria's war effort. However, the poor performance of Austria during the conflict is most typically blamed on poor leadership and planning. Greater cooperation could certainly help Austria to hold out a bit longer and more intact, but in the end would still be defeated and see its lands partitioned by the victors, unless by some means it was able to negotiate a compromise with the Entente powers. So let's now consider a post-war solution. The Central Powers are defeated and Austria is seemingly on the brink of collapse, but Woodrow Wilson, after having spoken with the Austrian Emperor, proposes that the lands of Austro-Hungary, rather than be fully partitioned or allowed to break away, should instead be actively reorganized into a federated United States of Austria, held to the standards of the Western powers for the sake of maintaining control in Central Europe, and in the long term supersede the expansionist Germany as the dominant Central European power. Austria may be framed in a more sympathetic light to help this motion gain approval, positioning the Austrian initiation of conflicts as an understandable response to an act of aggression by pro-Yugoslav agents, and that to allow the creation of a Yugoslav state would only justify the actions of these radicals who assassinated a high-ranking politician intent on reform. Austria was more a victim than an aggressor, and was deserving of a second chance. Moreover, the late Franz Ferdinand was deserving of that chance to finally bring about an age of balance and coexistence to Austria, and so it would be done. Across the empire, new states are raised with more uniform or compatible governmental structures, capable of extensive governing at the local level, while Vienna served as the hub of federal politics. The title of Kaiser is preserved and now plays a role more akin to that of a president, with a unitary parliament made up of representatives from across the Union. Much like the US, a bicameral legislative system would be put into use, with a Kaiser appointing representatives from each state to serve on a Senate, whilst the states elected a number of representatives based on population to a secondary house. Common law would be established through a federal constitution and through future decisions made by the federal government, whilst each individual state was free to govern itself as it saw fit. Minor land concessions would be made to Poland and Italy, however, Transylvania remains within the Federation, as does Bosnia. Agreements would be made for mutual defense and naval development, giving the Federation a strong conscripted army based on quotas issued on account of each state's population, further giving the Navy and federal government guaranteed access to Croatia's coastline, as it would be the Federation's only access to the sea. Functioning as a singular unit rather than a series of disorganized and varying sovereign states, the US of Austria is able to put the strength of its diverse lands to effective use in the post-war years, seeing to a steady recovery and return to great power status, while Germany still languished through debt and instability. Sharing a small border with the Soviets, Austria would adopt a widely anti-communistic stance, much like neighboring Poland, seeing the USSR as a potential threat to the recently achieved stability. This anti-Soviet sentiment might rise following famines in the Soviet West, when the ethnic Ukrainian lands of the Federation see an influx of refugees from the Soviet Ukraine. This fear of communist domination might serve to further strengthen the Federation's bonds, as small states aiming to go their own way could easily find themselves vulnerable to revolution, especially if leaving the Federation would negatively impact their economy and thus lower the standards of living for workers desperate enough to support such an ideology. With Russia no longer seen as a favorable force to guide the Balkans, both the great powers and the developing Balkan and Central European nations would turn to Austria as the sole alternative. Poland and the Federation, having already fostered friendly relations to disadvantage both the Soviets and Germans, should either seek to expand into their domain. France and Britain, having lost Russia as an ally, may now invest in the Federation to fill Russia's role as peacekeeper in the East, earning Austria the blessing and support of Western Europe's two great powers. The Federation's continued growth as the new great power of Central Europe, its budding military alliances with its neighbors, historic prestige, and direct support from the Western powers, would allow it to remain a check against the Soviets and later the Germans, who wouldn't be able to so easily annex the Sudetenland, Poland, or Austria itself, forcing Germany to direct its attention either westward or overseas to colonial expansion. This same standard going for Italy's attempted expansion into the Balkans, in essence averting what would have become the Second Great War. And that is where I'll end this video for now. The US of Z thanks you for watching. Support your Legion by liking the video, or join our ranks by subscribing for more. Mr. Z, out.